Surely those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors or advertisers.
A boy's born in hot damn Mississippi, surrounded by for world that ain't so pretty. His parents give him love and affection to keep him strong, moving in the right direction, living just enough for the city. His father works some days for 14 hours, and you can bet he barely makes a dollar. His mother goes to scrub the floors for many, and you best believe she hardly gets a penny. Living just enough for the city. Short, but Lord, her legs are sturdy. To walk to school, she's got to get up early.
Hello, hello, hello. We're here every Friday from 10 to 12 here on 1010 WOLB. It's the Frank M. Conaway Sr. Earl Show with co-host, attorney Tehma Smith Wilson.
Good morning, Baltimore and beyond, on this beautiful, brisk Friday. Thank you for listening once again. I am Tehma Smith Wilson. I'm an attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City. Some of the services that we offer include real estate and estate planning. So if you need to buy or sell your property, to purchase your ground rent, or to create or update your will or your deed, please give us a call at 667-334-7242. And if you would like to join the conversation and are not able to get through on the phone lines, please text your question or your comment to 667-334-7242.
All righty. And I call him the Dean. Our other co-host, Robert Bob the Dean Dashiell Esquire.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Today is the first day of the rest of your life. Use it wisely. If you need legal services relating to contracts or anything involving procurement at the state or local level, please give me a call, 410-547-8820.
All right, and yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, the telephone number to call is 410-669-1738, specializing in at-need, pre-need, pre-arrangement, seminars, veteran benefits. Veterans, please get your DD-214, cremations, and you know the drill. Everybody needs some insurance, or you might need to increase what you got. A couple announcements, and then we have a special guest with us, old friend of mine. First of all, you ain't got to cook on Sunday if you don't want. The House of Prayer will be giving you that food from 12 to 4. Let me put my phone down here.
You don't mean giving there.
No, you got to buy.
Yeah,
it ain't free. Thank you, Bob. Yeah. Okay. Tomorrow is Entrepreneur Day. Tomorrow, Saturday, September the 16th, at Gillis Memorial Christian Community Church, featuring Jay Alexander, who is the number 3 vlogger in the world, cruise vlogger in the world. He's going to show you how you can vlog. We're having Miss Lisa Borden, who's going to be speaking on marketing, finance, investments, and you. the Parkers, about business is a family affair. Yours truly will be speaking on getting your affairs in order. Dwayne Bimbo will be talking about finding my path in spite of. You will have a lunch. It will be interactive workshops and network connecting. That's at Gillis Memorial Christian Community Church tomorrow from 11 to 3, and that's 4016 Park Heights Avenue. And if you want to, you can register online through www.gillismemorialchurch.com. Now, if some of you don't have access to doing that, you still can come. Just fill out the application for registration because we're really kind of trying to get a head count because of the lunches. You know, when you got to feed people, you got to pay for that and per head, and we don't have enough. We got more food than we got people, you know, that don't gel out too well. So just want that's tomorrow from 11 to 3. The Gillis Memorial Church, 4016 Park Heights Avenue. And that's going to be Entrepreneur Day. On Sunday, this Sunday coming, will be Mount Hebron Baptist Church is going to be presenting. And if you guys have never heard this group, you're missing something. It's the Patrick Lundy and the Ministers of Music. Now, this is a choir, but the choir, Tehma and Bob, are made up of ministers of music out of the PG County, Washington, D.C. area. This guy has brought many of the ministers of music of these churches over there together in one choir. And truly, they are fantastic. Every time they come this way, I try to see them. And that's this Sunday at 3 o'clock at Mount Moriah Baptist Church. And that's 2201 Garrison Boulevard, where Reverend Stephen M. Smith. And the donation is $20 for that. And two memorial announcements on Monday will be the viewing and services of Miss Mona Lisa Marine, and that will take place at Park Lane Baptist Church. The wake will be 10. The service is at 11, and that's 3606 Mohawk Avenue. And on this Wednesday, September the 20th, from 4 to 7, will be the viewing of Miss Celestine Knight, former member of the Baltimore Fellowship Choir and one of the administrators from the State Taxation and Assessments Department at Park Lane Baptist Church from 4 to 7, 3606 Mohawk Avenue. Services will be Thursday, September 21st. The wake at 10, services at 10:30 at the Gillis Memorial Christian Community Church, 4016 Park Heights Avenue, and the interment in Druid Ridge Cemetery. Okay. We have a special guest with us. Those of you who might want to call in, the number to call is 410-481-1010, 410-481. WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. That means if you can't hear us too well across the radio waves, you can get us through the internet by doing so, or downloading the app. Okay. Tehma, you want to introduce Bob, you want to introduce our good friend who's on the line?
I'm happy to do that. With us this morning is former Baltimore City Council President from the late 1990s, I think, up until maybe 1999 or 2000, my good friend Lawrence Bell. Since leaving that office, he has been a community activist, particularly in the area, in the Mondawmin area of the city. And he is our guest today because most recently he has raised his voice in connection with a new proposed bike lane somewhere in the near or around Mondawmin, along Gwynn Falls Parkways. The community apparently opposes that move, and former Council President Bell is leading that effort. But so I welcome you, sir. How are you today?
I'm outstanding, and I want to thank you for bringing me on the program. You've been a good friend for many years, as well as my good friend Carlton Douglas. Carlton has been a friend of my parents.
Yes.
And, you know, one of the main reasons why I'm fighting this battle is because that I want to really protect the legacy of my mother and father. We've had a dental office at the corner of Arkansas Terrace and Gwynn Falls Parkway. I live in the community. I live over top of the office. And I'm concerned about how not only the gentrification has come in to displace a lot of our people, but also this effort to carve up the streets all over the city to reduce the ability of cars to pass through. I think it's outrageous. What they're proposing right now is that on Gwynn Falls Parkway westbound, from about Longwood all the way to the very end where you go, you end up at Leakin Park. They want to make the westbound lane, one lane for driving. And we don't want that. We think that it's a bad thing for the community. Also, I'm talking about the Department of Transportation of Baltimore City and the mayor as well. You know, they work for him. They want to put these flex posts, these ugly-looking sticks in the middle of the street and destroy the beauty of Gwynn Falls Parkway. So we're opposed to this, and we're going to be having a rally, actually, this coming Monday, Monday the 18th of September, right before the city council meeting. We're going to be there at 4 o'clock, and we're hoping that the elected officials will finally listen to us and stop the madness.
For our listeners, can you please give them some information on exactly how bike lanes are determined and what communities they go in, and if the community members have any say before, you know, the determination is made?
Well, that's an excellent question. It's hard for me to answer that question because here's the thing. Much of the damage was done during the COVID period. They were very slick, very dishonest, the city officials. I mean, everybody, you know. They had these little meetings where they cherry-picked who would be in the meeting. The meetings were all online, Zoom meetings, knowing full well that the vast majority of our people still are not really adapted to being at these online meetings. Not to mention, even those who were on Zoom at the time, 90% of us couldn't talk. And so they claimed to have the go-ahead to do this all over the city, even though they know, and I said this on a meeting recently, they were talking about, they're trying to redo Wabash Avenue and many other places. And I said, well, listen, you know that, and I'm talking to city officials now, okay, and that means the city council, the mayor, Department of Transportation, planning, all of them. I said, you know full well that the vast majority of people don't want this. You know they don't want it. Most people are complaining about North Avenue right now. North Avenue is a mess. It was a major thoroughfare across the city. And now it's like one driving lane.
Yep.
The traffic is backed up. It's outrageous. It affects the economy. It affects our ability to get around. I said, well, listen, don't take Lawrence Bell's word for it. You have the resources. Do a poll. Do a scientific study of the people, the residents of Baltimore City, and ask them. And whenever I say this, whenever I propose this, they hem and haw because they know that if they had a poll, they know that people overwhelmingly are opposed to it. So the question is this. Is this a democracy anymore? If democracy means the will of the people prevails, and we know 90% of people in Baltimore City not only don't like it, they can't stand it, they hate it, why is this still being done on these streets all over Baltimore City? That's the question.
Unfortunately, from my understanding, I know a lot of times when individuals try to do things in different neighborhoods, you have to get a buy-in, like a petition where a certain amount of residents sign off. Take, for example, if you get speed bumps in your street, or if you need a parking pass for a handicap outside your door, you need to get a buy-in from your residents and the people that lives around you in your community. It doesn't seem as if you have to get that buy-in for these bike lanes, which is unfortunate. And unfortunate, from what I heard, one of the ways they determine whether or not bike lanes go into a community is, number one, are there a lot of cars in that community? If there's not a lot of cars, then that's a ideal place to have a bike lane. Or number two, if there's not a lot of public transportation, and that's an ideal place to have a bike lane. So it gives people other options if you don't have cars and if you're not near public transportation. However, I think that that's a cultural issue, because I know for me as an African American, regardless of whether or not I have a car or whether or not there's public transportation around me, I'm not getting on the bike. So
right.
They use that to justify, okay, these are the places that need bike lanes. But if you have a bike lane, that doesn't mean that those other issues are solved, especially for us as a culture.
Right, right. Well, you know, I've been getting on a bike lately because I'm trying to get in shape. But I will tell you, most people in Baltimore City, the way the crime is right now, they're not biking at nighttime. Right? Am I right?
You're right.
A stationary bike or a bike that goes around the city?
A bike that goes around. They're not going to do that at night in Baltimore City. They're not going to do it during inclement weather, when it rains, when it snows, and all this. So,
or when it's hot.
So now, if you go around, you look at these bike lanes, and many of them are on major thoroughfares, right? Major thoroughfares. Count the number of bikes that actually go through. You'll see very few, if any at all. You know, I've been to some of these sites, and I've seen nobody in the span of an hour or two. Here's the thing. Several years ago, the city council passed a piece of legislation called Complete Streets. This was an effort by Councilman Ryan Dorsey, who was very tone-deaf to how people feel in the neighborhoods, okay? And what it did was it gave them the authority to go around and begin to do what they call street calming and to add in bike lanes, right? Now, one of the issues from the very beginning was the fire department opposed this because the International Fire Code, which Baltimore has adopted, says that streets are supposed to be at least 20 to 26 feet wide. Why? Because fire trucks, ambulances, EMS vehicles have to get through. And these people who are very fanatical about this forced this bill through anyway. And you'll notice that in many parts of the city, the fire trucks don't even try to get through anymore. Now, Gwynn Falls Parkway, for example, if you look at Gwynn Falls Parkway the way it is now, there's no way that an ambulance is going to be able to get through. People are not going to be able to pull over to the side to allow them through. And it could mean somebody's life. But these people seem to not care. And I'm putting this also on the mayor because, you know, we had a meeting about 2 years ago. It was a Zoom meeting during the middle of COVID. And he says, well, you know, I know you have concerns and all this is just in the planning stage. And he wasn't being honest about it. He knew full well that the plan was to do this. Now, I believe that you have to look at this in totality, right? Not only in isolation. And I believe that there is a plan to depopulate Baltimore City. If you'll notice, there was a piece in the Baltimore Banner recently that said that in the last 10 years, over 30 schools have been closed. Nearly all of them in the black community, by the way. Okay? We just saw Utah Mossburn was just closed. We've got Grove Park that just got closed. You know, they're trying to close down some other schools. I'm talking about West Baltimore and in East Baltimore. And so they are very hostile to black families. And they're planning to get many of us, and working-class white folks as well, out of the city. I think that's the plan, to bring in white-collar people who don't have children. So this is part of a bigger plan. And again, I think gentrification is something we have to look at, I think. And I'll say one other thing on it very quickly. This is not only something that is affecting the black community. I believe that we have a lot of friends in the white community who will tell you that they don't want these bike lanes either, you know? So I just hope that all of us will come together. Again, this Monday, we're going to be in front of City Hall at 4 o'clock, and we hope everybody will come down.
You mentioned planning. Who's running the Baltimore City Planning Department these days?
That's a good question. I will tell you this. I'm looking, I was over there for a hearing on another bill by Ryan Dorsey, that he calls it the Abundant Housing Bill. And I'm trying to remember the name of the chairperson. But this is another bill that planning has given the OHK on, which will allow developers to come in, investors to come into the city, purchase or acquire single-family houses and cut them up into small units without getting any approval from zoning, from the city council, anybody. And that's one of the bills that was drafted, that was created by Bikemore. Bikemore is the advocate for bicycle lanes. So obviously their agenda goes beyond just bike lanes. They're trying to depopulate the city, gentrify the city, and move a different population into the city and move a lot of us out.
Well, let me say this, Lawrence. This is Carlton Douglas here. How you doing, partner?
I'm outstanding.
Great. You hit on a subject I've been hollering about for eternity. First of all, this crap got started when Brandon brought this head of the Department of Transportation from D.C. over here, not knowing a damn thing about Baltimore, and being confronted by these bike folk that he ought to do all this crap, and Brandon went along with it. And I believe that you are absolutely correct that the majority of people in Baltimore think this bike lane crap is a bunch of crap, okay? You're absolutely right. I have to take my wife to work every morning, and we have to go down, because unless I come down 83, which is a monster in the morning because of the traffic, we take the long way, which is more expedient, and I got to hit North Avenue. And when I hit North, when I turn off of Drew Hill Avenue onto North Avenue, I am in traffic hell because of this damn bike lane crap. And about a month ago, a little over a month ago, they even set up a sting operation on North Avenue between Park Avenue and Utah, where if anybody, they had cops on the right-hand side, and if you cross Park Avenue trying to get in that bus zone, bus lane, or the bike lane, they was waiting for you to give you a ticket. And I mean, this thing was going on all morning long, tying up traffic, ticketing folk, setting them up to give them tickets. So I am 100% with you. And as far as the gentrification part, that could be possible. You might have hit on something they definitely don't want to talk about at all. And I am 100% with you on this thing. They need to get rid of all them lanes. If you go over there, if you take 25th Street to, I think it's St. Paul going down, and you make that right on St. Paul, it's a mess because you got that bike lane, and then they got people parking in that lane. It's like double parking, you know?
Yeah, by the way, and listen, by the way, since you mentioned Jude Hill, you go down Jude Hill to, you cross Martin Luther King, and that is outrageous.
That is.
You're talking about going down. Here's the question. How can elected officials allow a small little active group, a little special interest group, come into the city, carve up downtown and the neighborhoods, and just let them do it? I mean, just let them walk in. You know, it slows down traffic. It affects commerce. It affects the economy. I just can't understand why they will allow these people to do this. And that's another question. By the way, as you talk about, we talk about that and the gentrification, we received $641 million of American Rescue Act from the federal government. Where is that money? What is it being used for? Why is it being used to take some of these young fellas off the street, teach them masonry, carpentry, plumbing, pair them with minority contractors to rebuild these vacant houses so we have housing for our people right here? You know what I'm saying?
We've been asking that question ever since they got that money, and we ain't got a response yet from nobody.
And speaking.
Right. And
Go ahead.
Exactly.
Go ahead.
No, I was saying the other thing is that we've got infrastructure money. You know, the Congress, along with President Biden, passed, what is it, like $2 trillion of interest, almost $2 trillion for the infrastructure bill. That money is supposed to be used for repairing bridges and highways and all that kind of thing. But what I fear is they're going into cities like Baltimore, they're going to try to use that money, and they're doing what they call reconnecting communities. You've heard that term, reconnecting communities. And my concern is it really reconnecting disadvantaged black communities, like the communities where we had homeowners like at the Highway to Nowhere between Franklin and Mulberry. We had the highest percentage of black homeowners.
That's right.
Just about in the whole city. In the 1970s, it got wiped out.
Yep.
Now, here's what I'm going to say. Here's my thing. If we're trying to heal the harm, the remedy should be to create more black homeowners in that area, right? Isn't that the reverse? We don't need vacant lots, which they call, they give all these kind of names for them, but they're really just vacant lots, parks. We don't need more bicycle lanes. We need more home ownership for people that have been here and want to stay here, right? That's what we need to do. But again, I have concerns about that, and I think that's why we've got to make noise right now.
But then you also have to ask the question in terms of what are the priorities of the political leaders. You know, we have what the residents want throughout Baltimore City as well as throughout the state. But if the priority is climate control and going green, that's going to take precedence over any affordability or lifestyle that the Baltimore City has to offer. Take, for examples. Is already slated that Maryland is going to get rid of or will not be able to buy gas cars in the upcoming years. You'll have to buy a electric car from if you're purchasing a car in the state of Maryland. And also it's been announced that $25.5 million in grants is going to go towards Maryland bicycle, pedestrian, and trail projects throughout the state of Maryland. So when we vote for these political leaders and they have climate high up on their agenda or going green high up on their agenda, that's going to take priority over the type of lifestyle that African Americans want to have in the city when it comes to driving or when it comes to affordable houses or when it comes to, you know, renovating the houses that are vacant and making it affordable and livable for people in the city. That's secondary. And another example, and another example of this is the bus company that contracted a contract out to a bus company that's located in the state of California because they promised to go green with their bus routes, you know, by 2027. But now it's 2023 and the bus company cannot adequately bus their kids to school in their district. What has happened is the priority of going green and climate control has taken precedence over, you know, getting children to school and home at a reasonable time in this day and time.
Yeah, well, you're absolutely right. But here's the thing, and I think you just mentioned, as we transition to hybrid cars and then fully electric vehicles, that solves part of the problem right there, right? So why then should we also try to destroy the transportation infrastructure of these cities, which means that we're going to have congestion and it's going to affect business and it's going to affect people. So I think that there needs to be a balance. You know, there needs to be some kind of balance. But most of all, this, I think, also really does not speak well of the Democrats because we're supposed to be about democracy. And again, and I'll tell you one other thing. I know I'm branching off into another topic, but I think one of the problems, and I'm a registered Democrat. I've been elected as a Democrat. But I think one of the problems that the Democrats are going to have is all this money that has been appropriated back in early 2021, right? The major legislation, the infrastructure bill, the American Rescue Act, and the inflation reduction bill. How much of that money is going not just for reducing the carbon footprint, if you will, but how much of that is actually making its way to people like black business, for example, right? How much are we seeing of that? And maybe that's the reason why people are kind of lukewarm to the Democrats right now. I think they need to remedy this. So I think you got a good point.
And one last thing, before we heard about, you know, African-Americans complaining about the external gas regulators, and then Caucasians complained about the gas regulators, and then eventually a lawsuit was filed to prohibit BGE for putting gas regulators outside of individuals' properties without having their consent to do so. So I guess Baltimore City came together in that effort when they felt like they were being taken advantage of. Is there a lawsuit that could possibly be filed for citizens in Baltimore City to come together and try to prohibit bike lanes being put up in their community?
You know, that's an excellent question, and mm-hmm. You quite frankly reminded me of something I wanted to say. And I actually wanted to mention this to Robert. We are looking at the possibility of requesting an injunction for a number of reasons, one of which, by the way, is the fact that this does violate the fire code. And it also, there are a number of reasons why we think that this was done wrong from the very beginning. I'm talking about complete streets and this possible change. We got to move fast because Gwynn Falls Parkway is slated to be altered in October of this year, which is next month. So we are looking at that. I might also mention that when we have the rally on Monday, I'm going to be making a special announcement. We are getting new support that I think will really encourage a lot of people. I'm not at liberty to talk about it right now, but I'm going to make that announcement on Monday at 4 o'clock out in front of City Hall. But, yeah, if there are any attorneys listening who would like to help us with this, we welcome your help.
Lawrence, hold up because the lines are blowing up here. And if somebody wants to call in, we got one line open, 410-481-1010. Now, when I come to you, if you have a question or a comment for Lawrence, get right to it. If you're calling about something else, I'm going to put you on hold till we get to that, okay? We're going to start in this order. Bill Random, Mitchell, Gene, and James from Pennsylvania. All right, let's go with Bill. Bill, you got something for Lawrence?
Well, I'm going to just say, let me tell Lawrence, I'll be there Monday to stand with him, but I want to be on hold because I want to talk about some other stuff,
too. All right, going on hold. All right. Okay, let's go to Mitchell. Mitchell, you're on air about the bike lane.
Yes, sir. Good morning. Thanks for taking my call.
Mm-hmm.
Good morning to everyone, Mr. Bell. I came over there to your one meeting about the bike lane to support you. I live on the east side, northeast Baltimore. St. Louis Drive, where Lake Clifton used to be at. Man, they changed that. They made that one single lane. And like you said, coming up off of Washington, Wall Street to make a turn on the North Avenue, it's a nightmare. It's wrong. The mayor was on WBAL yesterday morning making the comment because they brought up about this bike lane issue because the former mayor, Sheila Dixon, is talking about addressing this issue. And he's saying that people in the city have to be used to getting prepared for the 21st century. So they don't care. They're making decisions about our life without us. They haven't came around to the community. And one, you 100% right, Mr. Bell, about what they did during COVID and changing the housing coding and changing what they've been doing with the lanes and this calming down of traffic. It's making it hard to get to work. They don't care. That council person, he must live downtown so he can walk. And I don't know how many people are going to be catching riding on a bike to go to the market or do anything. It's just, it's wrong. And we do need to have a lawsuit. And I'm not happy. It's just been a nightmare the last several years. And in my neighborhood, they did that to one of the homes. They changed a home on Duncrest, 4700. They changed it into a split-level apartment. And these were semi-attached homes. And they already started. And that house, they tried to sell that house for $289,000. My average home for my house for the last couple of years, it went from, I brought my house in 1999 for $63,000. But now it's up to, it was going for $180,000. 150 to 180 during 2020-21, but now I don't even know what it is now because of what they're trying to do. But again, they don't listen to us. They just do whatever they want to do. When you try to talk to your council person or call downtown, nobody's answering the phone about anything that you want to discuss.
Thank you, Mitchell.
Thank you.
And another thing that Mr. Bell said that rings a bell is that they're trying to redesign the city for individuals who mm-hmm. have no children or no families. So even if you wanted the bike to work, you know, and you had the capability, if you have children that needs to be dropped off at daycare, you know, you can't carry right. them on a bike lane right. with you. So you still going to need a car to yep. drop them off.
That's right.
And then
Amen.
If you want to be conscious, go home, get your bike, and then go to work. So this is definitely, as you said, perhaps a way to set it up for individuals in the city who have no responsibility other than themselves, who want to bike to work or bike to leisure, and they really don't have a kid or kids or a family.
Yep. Gene, you on air. Gene?
Yeah, this is Gene. How you guys doing? Happy
right.
Friday to everybody.
Same to you.
Yeah, okay. So really the 300-pound gorilla in the building is gentrification. And, you know, and everything we're talking about is about gentrification. Dropping your kids off and people who are the families have grown and now they're selling their big houses and so forth and whatever, moving into the city. So it's, if gentrification is the issue. Mr. Bell, when you were on with Darren Mohammed was frank about this subject. And he said is that black leadership, the colored people in NAACP, Negroes and some African Americans are following fake white liberals. This is what this is about. Mm. It's like traditionally the black community in politics have been integrationalist, reverse integrationalist, and following fake white liberals. and gentrifying the city. This is basically the has been the plan since Brown v. Board of Education, Brown 2. This is what this is the outcome. And
well,
so
let me speak to that. You're absolutely right. And I'm going to tell you something that concerned me a lot. After black folks supported Joe Biden, first in South Carolina and that, you know, that primary, which turned it around for him, and then, of course, in the general election, we put Joe Biden in the office. Am I right?
Yes. That was the agenda. That's the black agenda. That's the black movement. Going, you know, going back to
the best way to help us would be.
Yeah, but going back to Martin Luther King, and where do we go from here?
Let me say this. If he really wanted to do for us what we did for him, he would have appointed blacks at major department heads where the money is, okay, like transportation. Now, Pete Buttigieg said, I remember when he was running, and they said, well, black people won't support him, blah, 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 and all that. But if you go back and look at Google Pete Buttigieg in South Bend, Indiana, and black people, blacks in South Bend, Indiana were opposed to him. They didn't like him because he was gentrifying the entire city. He was moving black people out. He's now the head of transportation where all this money is.
Yeah. So, Mr. Bell, let's go back to urban renewal.
I'm agreeing with you.
Urban renewal. I know you agree. I'm agreeing with you. Urban renewal, Negro removal. This is nothing new. This is black people following fake white liberals.
Okay.
Let's go to James from Pennsylvania. James, you're on air.
Hey, how you guys doing today?
All right.
One thing I noticed when I used to live in Texas and I would work on the border, what they would do was you would have Mexican Americans who would have issues with migrants coming here. Now, it seems like what they're doing with them changing all these cities around and putting money and bike lanes and stuff like that, they was protesting all that on the border because it's almost like they was trying to do the same thing. And when they were like trying to split up homes, turn them into duplexes, they was against all that because the Mexican Americans said they felt like they was being replaced by the migrants that was coming across that border, even though they technically the same people. This is what my friend was telling me on the border. She's like, yeah, they my relatives. They all come from Mexico, but they come here on a different agenda. And it seemed like they using them to just replace us, and they got it wrapped up in all these different plans and stuff like that. Now, another thing right quick, and I like to hear your host respond on that, 80% of the world supply of oil has now been overtaken by China, Russia, Saudi Arabia, Iraq, and Iran. And they're pulling out of the green movement. I like to hear your comment on that. You guys always got an excellent show, and I listen to y'all off the air.
All right. Thank you.
I would like to comment on that.
Yeah, go ahead.
I was listening to a show, and they said one of the leaders in the green energy movement is England. They are years ahead of us when it comes to switching over to electric and going green. England's response or warning to the U.S. was, do not do it. Based on the problems and the issues that they're having now in terms of going forth in that direction, they told the U.S., slow down, do not do it. It's about 20 to 30 years out. Don't push the button. Don't aggressively pursue that. And as a American, I think that we need to be sufficient in everything, whether it's electricity, whether it's oil. We need to be able to do both. We shouldn't give up oil to be electric, and we should not stop electric and focus 100% on oil. The more options we have as a world leader and as we go forth in the world, the better, in my opinion.
Sarah, you on air.
Hi, this is Sarah.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to make two comments. First of all, concerning the bike lanes, it's going to be a nightmare trying to get the snow removal plows in and out, what have you.
Mm-hmm.
The other problem is that in the torrential rains that we've been having lately, no one is going to be riding their bicycles anywhere. They're going to get in their cars and go where they need to go. But if we continue to try and push these bike lanes on people, it really is a nightmare. And I, too, will be at the rally. I was at the last rally, and I will be at the one that's coming up on Monday.
All right, sir. Thank you. Let's go to Ivan. Ivan, you got something for Lawrence?
Yes, I do.
I have these neighbors. They have five cats, okay? And they raise these things as alley cats. They defecate on my property. This has been going on for 2 years. The police won't do anything. Animal control won't. And the health department out here in Cumberland, Maryland won't do anything. Okay. Now, can I take matters into my own hand and bait my trap and trap these things and set them free somewhere else? Can the police arrest me if I take that action?
What I suggest you do, Ivan, because we were talking about the bike lanes here, but what I would suggest you do is call animal control and report that situation, and they should be able to give you some kind of remedy. Let's go to Wayne. Wayne, you're on air.
Hey, good morning, family. I was calling about the electric vehicle thing. I heard Miss Smith Wilson saying something about, was it England said, don't do this yet? Is that what you were saying?
Yes, England, who is advanced in us when it comes to switching over and becoming more energy efficient and going green, they said, don't do it.
Don't
slow down.
Don't go electric.
They're saying slow down on your push to be all energy efficient and going green.
Oh,
they said, we are there now. We are kind of where you want to be, and it's not working out for us. So
right. I actually work in the fossil fuel industry. The company I work for, we haul gas. So it's kind of like I'm looking at it from that aspect. Also, the infrastructure is not ready. America don't have the infrastructure, and we probably 15 to 20 years out to have the infrastructure for that. Because if you look at the industry, particularly the electrical vehicle industry, they want a lot of stuff to go to trucks and the cars. And you know what happens to a battery when it gets cold? It depletes the energy of the battery when it gets, you know, sub-zero temperatures. So, yeah, they still got stuff like that. The technology is just not there yet to support the infrastructure to do all that. And we are ways off, and to me, they are pushing it too fast. Like, they want to have Maryland have electrical cars by, 2025, I think, or 2030, I think?
Yes, more around 2030.
Yeah, right, yeah. I mean, I don't mind the hybrid car. I don't mind having an electric car. Plus the prices. Prices are so high on electric cars right now. I mean, the average price of an electric car is $30,000 plus. That's used. You know, so I don't think that, like I said, and you look at the way the economy's going, most people can't afford that. I mean, you know, plus I like my V8. You know, I like my gas brand. I'm good at stopping at the gas station, so. All right. Oh, hey, Carlton, real quick. Uh-huh. The house of, I hate to get off the subject, but they selling the dinners this Sunday at the place on Liberty?
Yeah.
Are they selling the dinners?
Yeah, House of Prayer, yeah. They'll have that on
Yeah,
Sunday.
House of Prayer. Okay. Yeah. All right, thanks, guys. Uh-huh. Enjoy the show, too. All
okay.
Right. A comment from Mr. Fred on the text line says, mm-hmm. I've lived in the Hamilton neighborhood of Baltimore City, and we now have bike lanes throughout all of Harford Road, and is entirely disruptive,
yep.
to say the least. I've lived in the neighborhood for almost 50 years, and we definitely have no input in bike lanes.
Well, let me just say something before I go to Carlos. On that comment you made about Britain telling us, you know, we should slow down. I don't know how much we're going to be able to slow down with this climate situation. It is very inevitable to me, looking at what we've gone through this summer, that we got a serious problem on our hand that we've been told about for the last 50 years and nobody paid any attention. And we just now want to get on board to try to do something to limit this thing. And I don't know how this thing is going. I understand what you're saying and what the Britons are saying, but we got 350 million people over here and we still growing. They ain't got nowhere near what we got of the population over here right now. And if we don't try to do something, I mean something, I'm waiting to see what the winter going to be if the summer been off the chain like this with these floods, with these hurricanes, with these tornadoes, with the heat off the chain. We didn't have any snow hardly at all last year, which is not good for our health. because I do believe that the snow does help to kill some germs. I just don't know if we're going to have to be pushed to the point that we have to make a decision about that. And it's something we need to seriously think about, because it's coming for us.
And I agree with you saying, but climate is a global situation.
Right.
So even if we slow down, but China and Russia and all those other companies who make fossil
That's
fuels way yeah. dirtier than us,
yeah.
if they're picking up, we're still not going to be able to solve the climate situation, and the U.S. is going to be at a deficit.
Yep. Carlos, you're on air.
Yeah. Thanks for taking my call. Council President Bell still there?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm still here.
I have a question for you as a insider for Baltimore and a former city council president. Ask you a question: does the mayor of Baltimore control what goes on in Baltimore, or is there a conglomerate of interlocking directorates such as Hopkins and other nonprofits that control the decision making in Baltimore? That's my first question to you. Can you give me some inside information on that? And the second question would be, as an activist in Baltimore, and with 29-30% of the people voting in Baltimore, can you excite the voting population in Black Baltimore to come out and vote for you on this issue? And I appreciate your answer. Thank you.
Well, thank you for the question. We'll see what happens. Hopefully we can excite people. The mayor is autonomous. He has great power in the city. He is the CEO of the city government, meaning that he's like, he's the chief executive. All the departments and agencies, from transportation, planning, education, to some extent anyway, because now that's shared with the state. But the police department, the fire department, public works, we go on and on and on. All of them answer directly to the mayor. He's the chief executive. He is obviously influenced by private entities outside, right? And by the way, one of the concerns I've had for a while is that when Black people, when African Americans have become the majorities in cities around the country, there's often been a move by people, special interests, to cause the cities to divest a lot of their assets. And you'll notice this in many ways. You know, Blacks become the majority, and all of a sudden you see a lot of things being privatized or taken out of the city government. That in Baltimore, that began with Friendship Airport way back when, which became BWI. That was one time owned by the city of Baltimore.
You're right.
Today, you see these foundations like Friends of Druid Hill Park and others who act almost like they're government unto themselves, right? And that takes it away from the people as a whole. So that is a concern. Now, when you mention the those colleges and universities, I think it's great that we have Johns Hopkins and University of Maryland and Morgan and Coppin and BCCC and University of Baltimore. All that's great. But I want to see these entities do more in ways that will help the people that actually live here, right? I think that's important. I am not in favor of selling all or getting rid of all the city property. Like on the east side, I don't want to see Johns Hopkins take over half of East Baltimore, right? And move the people who've been there for years out. I don't think that's a good thing. So I think there needs to be a kind of balance, the right kind of balance. Hopefully, here's the thing too.
Hold up, Lawrence. We got another caller, because we're going into our second hour. So hold up, Irvin, go ahead.
And then I'm going to have a comment.
Okay,
too.
Go ahead, Irvin.
Yeah. Yes, Lawrence. I just wanted to. I support you 110%. I'm a Baltimore resident. The one thing that people don't understand, I'm bi-coastal from L.A. to Baltimore. The one thing that people aren't understanding is that bike lanes are regional. In Los Angeles, they ride bicycles all year round because the weather permits that. In Baltimore, we had four seasons, real hot, real cold, almost hot, almost cold. We have snow. So the point I'm making is one size does not fit all when it comes to bike lanes. And not only is that an argument – to remove them. But we have to realize that if it's 8 degrees outside and the bike lane makes it one lane, then the bike lane is still there, even though no one is using it. So I support you 110%, and I wish you would run for office again. Thank you for taking my call.
Go ahead, Bob.
Thank you.
In 2021, the median income for a black family in Baltimore was, the median net income, net worth of a black family in Baltimore was zero. For a white family, it was $69,000, according to an article that I read in the Banner, which I think is becoming more and more of a creditable source for information. What I'm saying is, we got to prioritize things. For a family that's working poor, they're struggling to keep food on the table. A bike lane is not the type of high on the list of priorities. It's what's on the list of priorities is getting a job where they can afford to maintain their family and preserve the family. That's the priority. And yeah, there can be some balance. But you mentioned Lawrence a few things that touched upon issues that I've come across. You mentioned a few times the American Rescue money, and what's happened to it. In the last few days, I've gotten more than a few calls from contractors for whom a great deal of money was supposed to have been allocated for COVID relief, for the increases in fuel cost and supply chain problems and so forth, the war in Ukraine. And the Baltimore City the Board of Estimates passed a resolution along a few months ago creating this program. But according to information I have, none of the money has actually been allocated to the departments for use, and none of the contractors have actually gotten any of the money that was supposed to have been made available to them. So, the question: what has happened to that money? If you know, if you have any information on that.
Well, you know what, I don't know until I know. Last summer there was a meeting over at Shake and Bake, Rec Center over on Pennsylvania Avenue. Right. It was about Druid Heights, Sandtown, I think Upton, Penn North. I went to the meeting. I was invited by some of the folks who said, we want you to be there. The meeting was packed with people. I mean, packed with residents, community leaders. Housing department was there planning. The mayor himself was there. And the announcement had been made that $20 million from the American Rescue Act was going to be used toward the community development around the city. I got up and I said, well, you know what? That sounds nice, but the entire allotment that came from the feds was $641 million. Why don't we see more of that money used to rebuild the city? And we could also help economically by involving black contractors and partnering, doing apprenticeships where we get some of these young guys. We can get young black men out there on the street, teach them these skills, pay them more money to help contractors to rebuild these neighborhoods than what they're getting out there selling drugs. So, to me, that's what made sense. It seems to me that a lot of this money is going to these nonprofit groups. They're not black nonprofits for the most part. I'm just keeping it real here, okay? And, what bothers me is that whenever there's a major incident, even like after Freddie Gray, you see money coming to the city, but then you don't see what happens to it once it gets here. And I think that part of the effort or part of the plan of the administration to stay in office is to spread this money around to some of these other nonprofit groups that they believe will support them or support him, but it's not having the impact that it ought to have if it was targeted to rebuild the city. I mean, that's my opinion.
Okay, Lawrence, we got two folk on the line that have a question for you, and we're up against the time here, so we're going to try to do this real quick. Because we're getting ready to go into the second hour. Deborah, quickly, please.
Good morning. Mm-hmm. My name is Deborah Morris. I'd like to make a comment very quickly. Everybody's off the track. Not about a black and white issue. It's about an administration issue. Okay? We have black leaders pulling down money that's supposed to be in the black community with the entire community being able to make comments or concerns or choices as to where that money goes. Plans have been made for this city back years ago, okay? We're going back to the 1964 time when it was cordoned off to whites only. The covenant is still in existence in the charter of Baltimore, Maryland.
Okay, thank you, Deborah. Let's go to James, quickly, please.
Yeah, this is going to be quick. Everything you talking about happened under Democrat leadership. And you are the ones that are talking. Y'all got to get the focus away from this Democratic Party. Because this is 50 years of doom and gloom. You got $600-something million. You all don't even know where the money going.
Thank you.
And one last comment from the lines. In the city with a majority black population and black leadership, black citizens have no one champion their concerns or problems in the city. Thank you, Mr. Michael.
Okay, Lars, we get where to go. We want to thank you for being a part of the Frank M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-hosts Tehma Smith-Wilson, Robert Bob DeShields, and, of course, myself, Carlton C. Douglas. But my last question to you before we got to go is, are you going to be running for office?
Well, I tell you, one time I would say definitely not, but I tell you, today, the way things are, I would consider it. I actually would, because I'm so worried about where this city is going right now. Okay. If everybody listening, please come down Monday at 4 o'clock. We're going to be outside of City Hall. We're going to try to make a difference. And thanks for having me on.
Well, we're not kicking you off. Well, you can hang around. Please do.
What time?
Yeah, I'm going to have to leave to go into meeting.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
What time, Lawrence?
Monday at 4 o'clock in front of City Hall.
Okay. Got you. Thank you.
Thanks for coming on.
That was former President of City Council Lawrence Bell with a very, very interesting topic that's been on my mind for quite a while with this bike situation. We get ready to go into the second hour of the Frank M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-hosts Tehma Smith-Wilson, Robert Bob DeShields, and yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas. We got a lot to talk about on that second hour. If you want to call in, it's 410-481-1010. 410-481-1010. Lot to talk about on this second hour. Don't go anywhere. Don't touch that dial. We'll be right back.
My brother's smart. He's got more sense than many. His patience.
Talking the day, soul at night. On the new 1010 WOLB.
Dear Vet Ticks, it was nice to spend the night with my daughter and other veterans. It's so humbling to attend an event when you feel appreciated.
I had a wonderful time with my family. Thank you for the memories, Vet Ticks.
Dear Vet Ticks, thank you for a great experience and for your support of the military and veterans.
Thank you so much, Vet Ticks. Our family has gone through a lot the last few years, and this gave us a nice break.
Every empty seat at a concert, game, or special event is a missed opportunity to say thank you to a veteran or a service member. By giving your extra tickets to VetTix, you'll help America's heroes reduce stress, strengthen family bonds, and create a truly happy memory that will last a lifetime. So when you really want to say thank you for your service, give the experience, give the memory. VetTix. Give something to those who gave. For more information on how you can make a difference, go to vettix.org.
Standing at the edge of a rocky shore, you breathe in the cool, salty air, watching the sun disappear on the horizon. Across the globe, someone begins their day along a sandy beach, listening to the rhythm of the crashing waves. You each envision a world beneath the water, vibrant life in every imaginable form. Now, imagine it's all gone. What was once a place of wonder and beauty.